Okay, our next speaker is Michael Büker. He's a science communicator and an astrophysicist. He's also a science journalist and a writer. So he's currently living in Dresden, and he wrapped his mind around this very question. So how do you measure these great distances, and how do you get an idea of how huge the cosmos really is, since the universe is like seriously huge? Michael, your stage.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone, for being here. Well, after the kind of year that we've had, it's natural to be thinking about where and how fast you might be able to get away from Earth. So let's all be a little bit like Maddie was a couple of months ago when she thought that actually the Voyager probe is winning, because it's quite far away, and we're going to be talking about even larger distances. But to think about distances in the universe and how we can measure them and how we can determine how far away stuff is from each other, it all starts when we look at the sky, because when we look up at the sky, all we see is basically moving dots. This is a nice picture that shows the Very Large Telescope, and above it there's the Moon, Venus, and the planet Jupiter shining. And these will be moving across the sky in a way that we are familiar with, but if they're just moving at the sky and every night the pattern repeats, how can we find out about the distances, how far these are away from us, from anywhere else? And we're going to be looking at actually how that works. Well, even in antiquity, this sketch is from 200 years before the Common Era, so it's more than 2,200 years old now. The answer was clever geometry. If you measure exactly at what point on our sky stuff appears at certain times, instead of just saying, well, it's somewhere up there and later it's going to be like over there. If you do this precisely, you can get a grasp at where stuff is and how far away it is from us and relative to each other. There was a small break in progress in this, because for a time people chose to believe that actually the Earth was at the center of the solar system, and then none of your measurements make any sense, so okay, we kind of wasted 1,000 years on that question. But then in the 1600s there came a very important breakthrough, actually two of them. First was Johannes Kepler, who found out that the way that planets move around the sun, including the Earth, follows a very specific mathematical pattern. And then this was comprehensively explained by Isaac Newton when he formulated the general laws of gravitation and how they work. So it was found out that these all follow a certain law. And from this you can determine the distances relative to each other. So they were able to tell how much exactly further away from the sun is the average orbit of Mars than Earth. So we had a relative idea of how far away stuff is from the sun, but we didn't know what the exact value was. So if during the 17th century you were to ask an astronomer how far away is Jupiter from the sun, he would say about 5 times as much as the Earth. But then if you ask him, well, how much is that in miles or whatever, they wouldn't be able to tell you. So with this one measurement, if we measured this AU, which stands for astronomical unit, which we just conveniently defined to say, well, the average orbit that the Earth has around the sun is one astronomical unit. If we found out that one value, we would be able to determine all the distances of all the planets in the solar system from the sun. And again, the answer was clever geometry. In a way that I'm not going to go into in much detail, when the planet Venus transits a star, we saw transits in an earlier talk, is when a planet moves in front of a star and kind of blocks the light from it a little bit. If you time this exactly and measure exactly the way that it moves from different points on the Earth, this gives you a clue. But there's a big problem, is that transits of Venus as seen from the Earth come in pairs, 8 years apart, which is okay, but that only happens every 120 years. So the very first one that was really observed was in 1639, but that was basically just one guy in England in his backyard, and he didn't really have colleagues, he didn't have good equipment and anything, so the number that he found was not very precise. Then astronomers spent, after Kepler and Newton had made their discoveries, astronomers spent decades preparing. They set up telescopes in different places in the Earth. They coordinated, they wrote letters to each other, but they were trolled by how they didn't really understand how their telescopes worked very well. So then astronomers said, okay, that didn't really work out. We're going to do it real well in 120 years. So again, they coordinated extremely well. The telescopes had gotten much better. They distributed around the Earth, which was easier due to railways. Well, you couldn't fly, but there was the railways and everything. So communication and transportation was a little easier, and they distributed all around the Earth, and they did this again in the 1870s and 1880s, and they were trolled by how their clocks were not precise enough. So, because the comparative measurements were off by as much as a minute in time, they didn't get a value as exact as they were hoping for. I mean, here we see 149 million kilometers, and then there's an uncertainty of 160,000. It's not so bad. Actually, in astronomy, that's pretty amazing for accuracy. But it's not enough if you're trying to send stuff to Venus. So they were probably hoping for the early 2000s to really finally find the true distance, the true value of the astronomical unit. But then before that, something else happened. So in the 1960s, big radio transmitters, radio antennas, became good enough to actually beam a radio signal at the planet Venus and then wait and measure how long it takes to bounce back. So we did a radar ranging experiment to the planet Venus. And that gave a value for this astronomical unit that was good enough to actually build probes that would fly to Venus. And then if you have something there, which is not just a wave bouncing off of the planet, but you actually have a spacecraft there, you can pretty much exactly time all the transmissions from the antenna on the spacecraft and everything, and that's how we found that value. So from this, we now know, and this is actually the defined value, so it doesn't change anymore. We just said that this is the astronomical unit, and we know that very well, and this helps us to establish all the distances in the solar system. Still, the transit of Venus that happened in 2004 and 2012, they just gave us amazing pictures like these, taken in Greece in 2004, or this one taken from a Japanese space probe in 2012. Now, if you weren't around to witness those, well, next one is up in 2120 or something, so just wait around. Now, as we moved towards the stars, so we've basically covered the solar system, but we also want to know how far away are the stars, which is the next logical step if we're looking outwards in the universe. We have to talk about the concept of parallax. And it's a bit complicated. It involves geometry, but we can cover it like sort of in a way of the layout of the Saal. So if there was someone up there on the rung of Saal 1, and they were looking straight at the stage and seeing me here and walking from one side of the Saal to the other, then first I would be appearing like a little to the left of their field of vision if they were looking straight ahead with their nose pointed at the screen. And then as they move to the other side of the Saal, I would appear in the other direction, and there would be an angle which corresponds to how far they moved. And if they precisely measure this angle and how far they moved, they can calculate the distance towards me. Now, in this Saal, that would mean about 40 meters, and it would be a parallax angle of about 10 to 20 degrees, and that would then give you the information that from up there, I'm probably about 50 meters away. We can do that with the stars. Now, on Earth, we can move from one place on Earth to the other, but that's actually a small baseline. That doesn't give us an angle that's a lot of fun to work with. But luckily, since Earth moves around the Sun all the time for free, we can just use that and measure the position of a star, wait 6 months, and measure it again. And we will be in a totally different place, well, basically 300 million kilometers away, and we can use that as a baseline for this measurement. So we look at a star, we wait half a year, we look at the same star, and precisely measure how much the star wobbles. Unfortunately, yeah, this leads us to the definition of the distance unit of the parsec, and the parsec is a unit of distance. Please do not confuse it with other stuff, as some might do. So how is the parsec defined? Well, if we have this angle, I told you that from Saal 1, from there to there, it might be something like 10 to 20 degrees. If a star is a parsec away, then over the course of a year, over our geometrical baseline of the Earth moving around the Sun 300 million kilometers apart in the two points, it would have to be the angle of an arc second. Now, what is an arc second? It's just an extremely small angle. You have a full circle divided into 360 degrees, and then each of these degrees is divided into 60 minutes, and then each of these minutes is divided into 60 arc seconds. And we're looking at an angle of one arc second that these stars would, over the course of 1 year, be wobbling in the sky from our movement around the sun. Let's take an example of looking at the International Space Station from down on the ground. You might have seen this. It's actually quite fun to see. You can look it up on websites at what point in time the International Space Station will be above you. And the angle of one arc second would be the size of an astronaut floating next to the International Space Station as you're looking at it from the ground. Obviously, you can't see an astronaut from the ground. That's because our eyes can't pick out the angle that is one arc second. Another example might be, again, for someone way up there at the end of Zal 1, looking at me at a distance of about 50 meters, the angle of one arc second would be the width of one of the hairs of my beard. And if you could see that, you would have a detector that's capable of distinguishing one arc second. Now, if we do that, and if we manage to do that, the telescopes are actually good enough to do this. One parsec is the distance to a star that wobbles by one arc second, but actually, our closest neighbor is even further away. So we don't have any star that does that. 1.3 parsecs is the distance to Proxima Centauri and the Alpha and Beta Centauri system. So these are even smaller. And 270,000 astronomical units is the distance to that one. So that means that it's way further away. I mean, in the solar system, we can move 2, 3, 5, maybe 10, 20, 30 astronomical units if we're doing well with our rockets and it takes a bunch of years. But to cover thousands or even hundreds of thousands of astronomical units tells us that the propulsion systems and the rockets that we have today are not capable of getting us to the stars in the way that we do it right now, which we also heard, of course, in the talks before. Telescopes on the ground are nice, but actually telescopes in space can give us an even better resolution. And the Hipparchus satellite, which was active in the last couple decades, measured up to 2 milliarc seconds. Now, think of it, the arc second with the astronaut in the sky and my beard and stuff. A thousandth of that as an angular resolution is what the Hipparchus satellite was able to measure. And this gave us the distances to basically all the stars in our field of view that were up to 100 parsecs away, and we know exactly how far these are away. The Gaia satellite, which is now just coming into operation, commissioned by the European Space Agency, this is about to have an even better performance. It will look at a billion stars, that's what it's called, the Billion Star Surveyor. It will be good for distances of up to 5,000 parsecs, and it's going to tell us the distances to all these stars, and it's going to be an amazing step in looking at how far away the stars are and forming a map of all the stars around us. And is there something missing? No. Let's talk about standard candles now, because that's another important tool apart from the geometry that we saw before. A standard candle is just something where you know exactly how bright it is, and then you can calculate how far away. A standard candle would be, well, like any, let's imagine a set of candles, and all of them burn at the same brightness. So if you measured the brightness of one of these candles, you could tell how far apart it was. Actually, maybe a better picture is streetlights in the night. If you see a car coming towards you, you can kind of estimate by how brightly you see the light if the car is still far away or if it is close to you, because you have an intuitive understanding of how bright the lights of a car should be if it's right next to you or a couple hundred meters away or many kilometers away if it's a clear night. And so we want standard candles in space. We want to have stuff in space where we have a good idea of how bright it should be, and then from how bright we see it, how much of the light actually reaches us, we can calculate the distance. And this we can do with the help of these, one of the most important diagrams in all of astrophysics, which is the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram. It basically sorts stars by their colors and by how bright they are. And because of the way that stars work, the color and the brightness are actually also intimately connected to their mass and what's happening inside the stars. And then if we see a bunch of stars, we can do this very well with clusters, which are groups of tens or hundreds up to thousands of stars in one place at basically the same distance. And they have sort of a standard population. then we can estimate how far away they are. Let's think of it like this. We just had the picture of the car in the night, which was light, but let's think of it as sound. Think of groups of children in maybe preschool, and let's imagine that every preschool group of children always had 20 children in it, just because. And now you can estimate how loud 20 preschool children just playing around actually are. And so from the sound of when you hear the children, you can tell how far away that group is from you. If we have a group of stars and we know the light, the different colors that they have, we can actually match it to this graph and see how far away this group is by estimating the properties that they have in this way. And so this then gives us an overview of basically our galactic neighborhood, so the other stars in our galaxy. The number of stars in our galaxy is about 200 billion, but before I bombard you with more numbers, we have a chance to get a great overview of what that's like from the artists of Monty Python.
Just remember that you're standing on a planet that's evolving and revolving at 900 miles an hour. That's orbiting at 19 miles a second, so it reckons.
Sorry.
Just remember that you're standing on a planet that's evolving and revolving at 900 miles an hour. That's orbiting at 19 miles a second, so it reckons. A sun that is the source of all our power. The sun and you and me and all the stars that we can see are moving at a million miles a day. In an outer spiral arm at 40,000 miles an hour of the galaxy we call the Milky Way. Our galaxy itself contains 100 billion stars. It's 100,000 light years side to side. It bulges in the middle, 16,000 light years thick, but out by us it's just 3,000 light years wide. We're 30,000 light years from galactic central point. We go round every 200 million years. And our galaxy is only one of millions of billions in this amazing and expanding universe. Just remember that you're standing. The universe itself keeps on expanding and expanding in all of the directions it can whiz. As fast as it can go, at the speed of light, you know, 12 million miles a minute, and that's the fastest speed there is. So remember when you're feeling very small and insecure, how amazingly unlikely is your birth. And pray that there's intelligent life somewhere up in space, 'cause there's bugger all down here on Earth.
Yeah. Thank you, Monty Python. Now, the numbers that they present have changed over time. Now scientists speak of 200 billion stars in the galaxy instead of 100 billion, but still, this gives you an amazingly good overall idea. And whenever I try to think of the parameters of the Milky Way galaxy, like 100,000 light years side to side, I just have the song in my head. And it works amazingly well. Except also for that one part where it says that the universe is expanding at the speed of light. Like we heard in the talk before, that's not actually true. The expansion of the universe actually exceeds the speed of light, but come on, they're comedians, so cut them a little slack on that one. Other galaxies, the Milky Way galaxy that we've just gotten this nice overview over is by far not the only one. There are other galaxies, and we are part of groups of galaxies. Actually, the one that's called the Local Group, which has three very large galaxies, which is ours, the Milky Way, the Andromeda galaxy, which is actually larger, and another one which is a bit smaller, and then there's a bunch of dwarf galaxies also moving around there, and we're going to be looking at how we find out about distances in that regard. Now, again, we have a sort of standard candle here, and these are stars called Cepheids, and what you see here is the brightness of the star pulsating. So you look at the star and you say, okay, it's this bright. Oh no, wait, it's dimmer again. Oh wait, it's getting brighter again over the course of a couple days. And if you measure this brightness very precisely, you just have to wait a few days. It's not a difficult measurement in that regard. You can find out that the duration of these variations is actually closely linked to how bright they are. So calculating or measuring the period of these oscillations gives you the brightness, and then these stars, called Cepheids, can work for you as a standard candle, and this works out to into other galaxies. So we look at like the Andromeda galaxy, which is a couple of million light years away, and we see a Cepheid star in there somewhere. We measure the period of its oscillations, and then we can tell how far apart it is, and this gives us a good idea of how far away that galaxy actually is. That doesn't work for galaxies where they appear so small in our field of view that we can't point out a single Cepheid star. So these groups of galaxies also form together into something called superclusters, and the Virgo supercluster is an idea of what our group is actually. And so I mentioned the local group of a couple of maybe 100 dwarf galaxies and three large ones. And this is actually orbiting something called the Virgo cluster. So we're a bit out. But yeah, I mean, this is an abstract graphic. What does it look like to look at the Virgo cluster? Well, we can look at that. And you see that we look at the sky, and there's just a bunch of large galaxies there. You're looking at something that's probably pretty similar to what our own galaxy is like, and it's just hanging there in the sky. And by, for example, the Cepheid measurement method, we can get an idea of how far away it is. But these local galaxies are not the only ones we see. An example that's called the Hubble Extreme Deep Field, where the Hubble Space Telescope that's orbiting the Earth took pictures of a very small patch of the sky. Here the moon is shown to scale, so if you look at the moon, then the photograph that I'm about to show you right now shows this small part that's marked by the XDF. And if you look at it long enough and collect a lot of light, that's why it's called a deep field, it actually looks like this. And there's a huge amount of galaxies, and they all look different. Some are spiral galaxies, some are elliptical galaxies, and they even have different colors. Some appear red, some appear blue. And this all has to do with the way that they evolve, and we're not even done quite in understanding how they come to look like that. You can actually help with this. There are so many galaxies just recorded in pictures that we don't have good catalogs of them all, so you can visit galaxyzoo.org, and they will show you a picture of a galaxy somewhat like this, and you have to click, is this a spiral galaxy? Is it an elliptical galaxy? Does it look like blue color? Does it look like red color? It's crowdsourced citizen science, and you can help classify a whole bunch of galaxies, and it's a lot of fun just to click through while you should be working. Now, also when we look at these galaxies, similar to the way that we can look at stars with the Cepheids and their variation, there's a bunch of methods. I'm not going to get into a lot of detail, but if you look at the galaxies and the way that they move and the way that the light emanates from them, in some way you can correlate that to the distance. So examining these galaxies very closely can give us an idea of how far away they are from us. But actually, everyone's favorite standard candle, the one thing that astronomers and astrophysicists really love to use, is supernovae of the 1A type. Now, in the talk before, we saw that sometimes little white dwarf stars can gain mass from their companion stars, so stuff is falling onto them, until the mass of this white dwarf star that's gaining weight becomes so large that it explodes in a thermonuclear explosion, and this then is a supernova of type A. And what's amazing about these explosions is that basically they are almost the same brightness. Or you can determine the brightness very well if you look at how fast, how quickly the light fades out. So whenever we see, like you see here on the top left picture, whenever we see a galaxy and there is a supernova 1A happening right at that moment, and they only are visible for a couple of days mostly, hours to days. So if we look at that closely and we measure how the light fades away, then we can get a very good idea of how far away that galaxy is. And even larger structures emerge then, and we think about the Virgo supercluster that I just showed you, which was groups of galaxies around groups of other galaxies. And the latest idea of the sort of the large-scale structure that the Earth and our Milky Way is part of is the Laniakea supercluster that was proposed just 2 or 3 years ago. And here you don't even see individual galaxies. It's more like the density of stuff in the universe that's grouped together, and you see these lines. They represent sort of the way that gravity is pulling everything. And yeah, that's a pretty amazing idea. And like we've heard in the talk before, the universe is expanding, and this also affects the light. The light gets redshifted. If there is a light wave traveling through the universe, and while it's traveling, space expands, that also means that the light changes its wavelength. It just becomes a different color, and it shifts towards the red, which is why this thing is called redshift. And so galaxies that are very far away, because between us and where that galaxy is, space is expanding and has been expanding for a while, these galaxies appear to look red. And we can actually see that in the pictures, like this one. Yeah, you can see it on the screen. It's this very faint red dot. And that actually tells us that this is a galaxy which should actually have blue light, like most of the other galaxies, but because it's so far away and space has stretched while the light waves were traveling in our direction, it now appears red. And 4 gigaparsecs, so we're looking at 4 billion parsecs of distance towards this, which we can kind of extrapolate from how far it's redshifted, so how far the light has been reddened, is how we can get an idea of this. And it's not just the one. This, at least a couple years ago, was the furthest away galaxy that had ever been observed. But actually, there's a whole bunch of those. And they are everywhere. And like we saw, there's a very large number of galaxies to be seen everywhere. And to give us a final idea of how matter is really distributed in the universe, I have another video, which is a simulation of how these super galaxy clusters are actually distributed. So let me pull that up. Now we're looking at some generic super galaxy cluster, and we're kind of circling it. And as the camera is moving out and the picture is getting larger, we see that this one super galaxy cluster is actually sort of connected to other regions where there is a high density of galaxies. Remember, this is not stars. We're looking at galaxies. And they are sort of strung together in something that's called filaments. And these filaments stretch along the lines of regions where there is almost no galaxies, which are called voids. And these voids are between 10 and 50 million light years in diameter, more or less. And this is just the way that everything stretches out. So super galaxy clusters are gathered in filaments around voids, and it looks like a sort of a soap bubble or maybe a beehive structure. And okay, this is a simulation, you know, it looks nice. And this is gathered from data that we have about how far away these galaxies are, how we think the universe evolved. But how about real data? Can we look out there and actually measure galaxies and actually measure how stuff looks and see the structure in the universe? Turns out we can, and it looks like this. And it just blows my mind. Because you see this whole beehive structure, you see the voids, you see the filaments of super galaxy cluster structures sort of strung together. And that's just real data. That is the largest scale structure of the galaxy, of all the galaxies of the observable universe that has ever been recorded. And this relies on the measurements of type 1a supernova and of the galaxies, which relies on measurements of, for example, the Cepheid stars, which rely on measurements of the parallax, of the geometrical parallax, like we discussed here in this room. So the way of looking at the universe like this, of all the super galaxy clusters, actually begins when we string together these to form what's called the cosmological distance ladder of all these different methods building up upon each other. And it starts right here when we look up at the sky. So I hope you enjoyed that. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much, Michael. So we still have time for questions. Line up at the microphones if you want to ask any here and now. And we get a little preference on the internet. Are there any questions, Signal Angel? That doesn't seem to be the case. And we start with microphone 3, please.
Regarding the redshift of the further away galaxy, red light has less energy than blue light. Where does the energy go?
It's lost. In the process of the universe expanding, energy is not conserved. And that's a big headache for physics.
Microphone four.
So I was thinking that in the case that you try to measure the distance to a faraway galaxy, where we're in the talking in the scale that there's not sufficient accuracy via parallax, so you rely on supernovas. So you point a telescope in a patch of the sky and you pick out a supernova, but you cannot really know, I suppose, if this supernova that you're watching belongs to the galaxy where all the other stars around it are, or perhaps it's very far away on the z-axis, on a different galaxy that's just behind. Is that possible? How do you go around that?
Yes, you're right. You may find pictures, and I may find a picture of this, where galaxies are actually overlapping. So in this thing that I showed you from the galaxy zoo, I think you see some galaxies overlapping. Now, this might mean that they are close together and actually colliding, but it might also mean that they just happen to be in the same direction. But then the S1A, the type 1A supernova, if you measure it, gives you an idea of how far away it is, and then hopefully you can estimate if it was the front galaxy or the back galaxy. But you can't be exactly sure, you're right.
Okay, microphone one, please.
Hello. Okay. Yeah. Thanks for this. Is really fascinating. This might be a stupid question. If the outer edges of our observable universe is expanding at faster than the speed of light, and we detect very far away galaxies with light, how is the light ever reaching us?
We see only as far as the expansion of the universe will allow us, and like we heard in the talk before, stuff is falling behind the horizon. There are regions in the universe now where, at a later point, because space is expanding, the light from these regions will not be able to reach us. So if we look way out into the universe, to the very edge of what we can see, there is stuff disappearing there, and yeah, there's just no getting around that. If it's gone, it's gone.
Okay, this concludes the Q&A. A warm round of applause for Michael Büker.